Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, in the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful. Assalamu alaikum, my dear respected viewers, and welcome to the 20th episode of the Treaties of Rights series with your host, Ali Jassim. Today we will discuss the right of the neighbor. Regarding this, Imam Sajjad Zain al-Abidin, Allah's peace and blessings be upon him, has said, "And the right of your neighbor is that you should be a guardian for him when he is absent, and you should honor him when he is present, and you should assist and support him in both situations. You should not pursue any of his imperfections, and you should not seek any of his faults. But if you should discover any of his faults unintentionally, you should take role of a fortified stronghold and a veiling screen regarding what you know. You should guard him in such a way that none of his defects can be discovered, even if they are thoroughly inspected with spears. And you should not eavesdrop on him, and you should not forsake him during times of hardship. And you should not envy him when he receives a blessing. Pardon his deviation and forgive his mistakes. And do not lose your temper when he behaves out of ignorance with you. And do not stop to be his supporter and answer those who scold him. And divulge for him the deception of those who counsel him, and associate with him in an honorable manner. And there is no power or strength but in God." First, let's take a look at the definition of neighbor. In Arabic language, jar is used with several implications in the Holy Quran. In some places, it is used to refer to neighbors close or far away. In the Holy Quran, it is used to refer to those who seek asylum in the following verse. If one amongst the pagans ask thee for asylum, grant it to him. The Holy Quran Al-Tawbah, chapter 9, verse 6. The above word used for neighbor has the deeper meaning of security. That implies that neighbors are granted security by each other. The right of a neighbor is great both intellectually and religiously. In Islam, everything has a right. This includes neighbors. Muslims are obligated to respect and honor their neighbors. In the Holy Quran, it says, "Serve God and join not any parties with him, and do good to parents, kinsfolk, orphans, those in need, neighbors who are near, neighbors who are strangers, the companion by your side, the wayfarer, and what your right hands possess." The Holy Quran An-Nisa, chapter 4, verse 36. The first refers to some of the rights in Islam, including those of neighbors. Neighbors who are near in this verse have been interpreted by various commentators to imply various things. Some consider it to apply relative. However, since the verses that have preceded this verse in the Holy Quran refer to the rights of relatives, this interpretation seems to be an unlikely meaning. Rather, other implications seem to be more appropriate. It may mean neighbors who are closer to us in religion. Neighbors who are strangers implies physical distance. According to traditions, people who live in up to 40 houses away in either direction are considered our neighbors. It may also refer to non-Muslim neighbors who are not fighting with Muslims. Islamic teachings and values should reflect more on an individual's actions rather than their words. Their actions should reflect that they are Muslim and not their tongues. The behavior that reveals our true Islamic identity is how we treat others, and in specific, neighbors. It doesn't matter that your neighbors are not Muslim or that they don't have the same set of beliefs that you do. According to Islam, treating them in a proper manner is not an option. Imam Ali, the commander of the faithful, peace be upon him, has said, "Man is either your brother in faith or your brother in humanity." Time for a quick break. Stay tuned. The Quran tells us that all of mankind is descended from one couple, Adam and Eve. Thus, we are all brothers and sisters, and our differences in languages and colors are but a mercy that we might know each other. Language and race should never be a reason for discriminating against people. A Muslim must be good to his neighbors no matter what their religion is. The Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and his pure progeny, taught us that a neighbor is not just the one next door, but includes all those up to 40 houses in all directions, effectively a whole neighborhood. Prophet Muhammad was told of a woman who prayed during night and fasted a lot during the day and gave alms generously, but whose neighbors complained of her abusive tongue. He said that she would be in hellfire. When Prophet Muhammad was told of another woman who did not do all of those extra acts of worship other than just compulsory the wajib, but whose neighbors were happy with her, he said that she would be in paradise. Thus, we see the importance of being good to our neighbors, both in actions and words. In the Holy Quran, Allah says, "Worship God and join none with Him in worship, and do good to parents, kinsfolk, orphans, the poor, the neighbor who is near of kin, the neighbor who is a stranger, the companion by your side, the wayfarer. Verily, God does not like such as are beautiful and boastful." Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, his spirit family, on the rights of the neighbor said, "It is to help him if he asks your help, to lend him if he asks to borrow from you, to satisfy his needs if he becomes poor, to console him if he is visited by an affliction, to congratulate him if he is met with good fortune, to visit him if he becomes ill, to attend his funeral if he dies, not to make your house higher than his without his consent, lest you deny him the breeze, to offer him fruit when you buy some, or to take it to your home secretly if you do not do that, nor to send out your children with it so as not to upset his children, nor to bother him by the tempting smell of your food unless you send him some." Here we see that Allah and the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, have greatly emphasized on the importance of neighbor. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, has said, "Whoever believes in God and the last day, let him not harm or annoy his neighbor." There are many traditions about the rights of neighbors, their due respect and their role in our security. The Prophet of God said, "The neighbor because of whom one locks the door out of fear for one's family and wealth is not a believer." The Prophet of God was asked, "O Prophet of God, what are the rights of neighbors incumbent upon other neighbors?" He said, "The least of a neighbor's rights on him is that if he asks him for a loan, he should grant it to him. If he asks for help, he should help him. If he wants to borrow something from him, he should lend it to him. If he needs him to donate something to him, he should do so. If he invites him, he should accept his invitation. If he gets sick, he should go and visit him. If he passes away, he should attend his funeral procession. If he receives some blessings, he should be happy and not be envious of him. If a tragedy befalls him, he should grieve for his grief. He should not build a tall building in front of his dwelling, which would trouble him due to its overlooking his house and obstructing the passage of breeze. If he is presented with some novelty in his house, then he should present him a part of it if he knows that he does not have something like it. Otherwise, he should conceal it from him and his family if he desires it for himself." The Prophet of God then added, "Listen to what I tell you. Only a few people who are blessed by God's mercy fulfill the rights of neighbors. God enjoined on me the rights of the neighbor to the extent that I thought he would appoint him as an heir." There are three important points stressed by the Prophet in this tradition. The first point is that each other's house is this place of peace and security, both for his property and for honor. Should one lose his security at home, he has lost his most secure stronghold. This peace and security is everyone's certain right and should not be violated by anyone. If one lives in such a way that threatens the security of his neighbors, then he is not a true believing Muslim. The second point that is stressed here is not to build a tall building overlooking other people's houses. We all know that at the time of the Prophet, there were no tall buildings in Arabia. However, the teachings of the Prophet are universal and for all times. Thus, he instructed us not to build such buildings. This is one of the signs of the completeness of the Islamic teachings and a proof of Islam being the last religion. Housing is still one of man's major social problems. The problems of finding a secure place to live is not only one of our problems, but it is also one of most countries in the world. The Westerners have chosen living in apartments with all its problems and limitations. Our people are also following this practice. The third point that is stressed is that one should not show what he brings into his house to his neighbors, or give a little of what he brings home to his neighbors if they are poor. In Islam, hurting neighbors in any manner is forbidden. Regarding this, Imam Sadiq, Allah's peace and blessings be upon him, says, One who troubles his neighbor is cursed. Also, Imam Sadiq narrated that someone complained to the Prophet of God about his neighbor. The Prophet turned his face away from him. He came back again. Then the Prophet told Ali, Salman al-Miqdad, go and publicly announce that the curse of God and the angels is on the one who troubles his neighbor. On the other hand, pleasing one's neighbor is a cause of forgiveness. In Lubab al-Lubab, Qutb al-Rubandi, quote, on the authority of God's Prophet, anyone who dies with three neighbors pleased with him will be forgiven by God. We have reached the end of this episode. Stay tuned for another episode on the Treaties of Rights. Thank you all for watching, and may Allah hasten the reappearance of our beloved Imam al-Mahdi. Peace and blessings be upon him. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.